a tree frog. It's ordeal that trial to survive.
Oh. That's rude. I gotta get my tunes back. Just building new scenes on the fly here. I'll probably need this for the live coding scene? No. No snake eater theme while we code. Oh, hold on. I have all kinds of problems today. This is ridiculous. Is that better? Yeah, I think. I had at a corner of my green screen, not in the frame, or the other way around. The real world was leaking through because I wasn't matting it out. So, this is where we are. We're pretty much done. Just a few things to tighten up. Okay. So let's see what's on tap. So much bullshit going on today. Technical problems. I had OBS refuse to start. It was crashing every time I tried to start it up. I had some resolution problems with the PS3 source, so my Elgato was acting kind of weird. But hopefully that's about it. So I have a few nice to have features that I want to get done here before I dive into actually playing the game. And what are they? Well, so I've got these short names for each of these items, not all of them, but some of them. And I'd like to get some of those rendered out here, so let's see. Um, So if I wrap this in a little div, Flash on Fedora doesn't like Twitch. Oh, I'm sorry, Palindate. Well, this is unexpected. What am I? Item is not defined. Why? Look, it's right here. All right. Super weird. So in JSX we can use Boolean test to short circuit a thing. So I guess what I can do is if I have a short name, I can render it in parens using the string interpolation template strings. What I want to avoid is having empty parens when there's nothing to render. And so what's kind of nice is that by default, it looks like the span is rendering with a little bit of a de-emphasized color. Yeah, see, none of these have short names. But these ones. Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, the short names are often alphabetized. I wonder if I wanna resort this list a little bit. So I have, you know, Snake A up at the top here. I don't know which is gonna be more annoying. I also feel like there's just not enough space around this thing. Can I force a space in there? Yes. Okay. Can I do it without the extra element? Yeah, okay. That's a weird JSX quirk. You know, white space control in HTML documents is kind of weird to start with, where if you have more than one space, they collapse. They get swallowed together. But because JSX is like a DSL, it's really being evaluated down into function calls to ultimately maybe generate a DOM node. The white space handling is a little quirky.
Someday you'll feed on a tree frog. It's so deep, the trial to survive.
I think I'll leave. Let's see what it looks like when I resort the groups. So sorting by name is cool, but what if I sort by short name and name? How does that feel? Guess that's not too bad. Yeah, I like that better. And obviously that's a flat sort for the stuff that doesn't have a short name. It's irrelevant because they're all going to be undefined. And at least it kind of gives a rationale for why the list doesn't look alphabetical by default. FYI, I don't see your editor if you're intending to share it. Yeah. I got you, Palindé. I'm trying to make sure right now that things are looking appropriate in the game context. Just tidying up a little bit. White space, just cleaning up. So, yeah, I think that was the biggest thing I wanted to address as far as the actual front end goes. Everything else is looking okay. So, final checks would be to basically do a production build of the front end app. And then put it somewhere where the Rocket app can serve it. I mean, I don't have a whole lot of latency, and things are not like terribly unresponsive right now. But I wanted to see if I could get some kind of relief from these alternating response times. So if you see here, if I send an XHR request to the server, sometimes it's just around 30 milliseconds, and sometimes it's about 10 times that. And so that's very fishy. And actually, this is not, there we go. Oh, interesting. Yeah, that's right. I need, so this is something that I can resolve actually. So the click handler for toggling the checkbox is attached to the label and the checkbox itself. But I could lift that out and I could associate that behavior with the list item, which would make it a little easier to operate. So let's check that out. Yeah. So let's see, we've got list item right here. And so normally we would be sending on toggle. So what if I pull that out and I say instead, on item click, which is a property that the list item exposes, and I can go back through to collectible item and in theory remove the on toggle entirely. Which is a little weird, you know, because I've got the checkbox component right here, which is listening to the value of collected. Okay, that doesn't seem to work at all. Super cool. Looks like I've got an error though. Unknown prop. On item click. Well, what did I just read? I thought I just read about this. Oh, it does get, does get a slightly different signature, so that's something, but I need to figure out why on item click is, oh, it goes all the way on the top, it goes on the list itself. So they've uncoupled it from each item. Here's the list. And so if I want to couple this with the handler that I've got here, we're getting to the rust, Palindic. We're almost there. There's so few things to tidy up here. So we get event and data is meant to represent all the props that get passed into the item, the list item. And since I am passing in my collectible item, I should be able to say data.item in here. And let's see. Let's see if that flies. This is still really mad. On item click in list conflicts with props. Cannot be defined together, choose one or the other. So well, that broke. Wow. All right, so on item click, yeah, so this is all dumb. So what's going to happen is on click, I'm going to do stuff. And yeah, so I guess on item click is meant to be for when you're doing something kind of like what we had with the tabs, where you've got a data structure that is defining shorthands. So this is like the menu item is defining what the tab presentation is like, and then the render property of this object is meant to return a component for the top tab content. So that's kind of like what they were getting at, I think, with on item click. Anyway, all right, there we go. We're back in business. I just had the wrong callback name when I was doing it directly on each item. So that's nice. Now I can click anywhere on the item line to activate that toggle. That's exactly what I want. All right. So what now? I do kind of want to get like a total percentage or a total count of collected items. I mean, that would be nice, but let's see if that's trivial, then I'll go ahead and add it. So how would I do that? So maybe I would get the collectibles here. And I'll just have a div with props item size. So I'll get a count. And then finally I'll wrap all of this in a div. Take the count here. Okay, so I see it. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a class name on here called total count, and then I'll use that to try and position this a little bit. I'll pin it to the right side, and I will give it a background of panel BG and a color. I guess the color is going to stay where it is. Make it big. Oh, panel BG is not what I want. I want like item BG. Padding, and I'll drop the top like 2 pixels or something, just so it's not butted right up against the top there. Oh, you know what? So there's got to be what does a label look like, right? This kind of thing. Elements, label, label. So that could be good. I don't know if that usage is correct. Let's take a look at the source here. Oh, yeah, I guess that's probably pretty close. And so if I want to get the colors to look right, I need to override UI label. And what about size? Do we have bigger labels? I think big or huge is probably in line with, oh, okay. Yeah, that looks in the ballpark. And so I'm going to compare roughly. So this one's got a little less padding. want to get a sense of what the top offset is. I don't actually. I don't know what's creating that little gap there. So I am going to have to ballpark it, I guess. What was the next one? Huge. I like big better. So rather than waiting for the compiler to get me what I need, I'm gonna just play with the offset here. Before, see if I can squish the stuff together. Three. Yeah, okay. So top offset of 3. And then I'm going to switch this to the lighter one, which is active item BG. And then I think that's good. How do I feel about the... the spaces between the counts. Let's bring that in. Yeah, that's better. All right. That's feeling pretty good. Okay, great. So, now I guess I'm up to what Palande has been looking for, which is back to the Rust stuff. Just trying to rearrange my windows a little bit here. Okay. So I'm going to put all the front end away. And, I am gonna kill the dev server there, and then I'm gonna do an npm run build. And so this is me basically saying, you know what, we're done with the actually. Show me what I got. All right, so there's a build directory there. I'm gonna just wipe it out. Oh. Okay. Now, as I was saying, npm run build. Just want to make sure that everything's nice and clean before I dump out my assets. And so if I go back up to the top of my repo and look at my main.rs, the general idea here is that I'm going to be adding another mount. And this mount is going to be at slash. And I'm going to configure a route to basically to do a pass through. So it's going to just slurp up matching file paths from disk and serve them up as a response. And I believe Rocket has a way to do that, but I don't know what it is. So it's time to look at the docs. Let's see. So we'll look at the guide and there's something about like named. No. How is this not like something that is immediately findable? Why are you making me work for it, Sergio? Because I think that the responder is called like named file responder or something. So assets is giving me nothing. File gives me nothing. This is not very searchable. Okay, search guide. Maybe this is better. Static is getting me a bunch of results about lifetimes. I'm glad he added a search. That's good, but again, this is kind of bullshit. I'm just going to start taking pot shots, I guess. We just start looking through. Well, yeah, as shitty as it is, a really common, and I'm going to say this lightly, but a common problem with Rust projects, and I think this is a problem with a lot of languages that have type systems. The documentation suffers because the types are doing more for you, and so there's more of a tendency to kind of punt on docs and just show examples, which are good. It's good to have complete examples, and it's way better to have here we go, static files. It's much better to have complete examples than snippets, you know? Like that's a big deal. So in this example project, he's got a static directory with I don't know what hidden is. We'll see, but it's got an index.html and a rocket icon. Okay. Oops. And so in the source, he should have, oh yeah, there it is, named file. Named file. All right. So this is the gist. And yeah, it's just kind of a shame that such I think pretty much anyone who's building a web application with a framework like Rocket, serving up static files is going to be a very, very early thing that they're going to want to do. So, I don't know, I may offer him a pull request for his docs to say, hey, you know what, this should be right there, front and center. Because this is not complicated. It would be trivial to just talk about it. Interesting. So, rocket response named file. That's what we're looking for. So that's the first piece. We get the module use in there. And then what else? So we need a few routes. Oh, I also need standard IO for the result type, I guess. And some path stuff. Oops. So that all looks like stuff we need. I'm gonna reorder my uses here. Actually, it's a little sloppy right now in here because I've got submodules inside this main module. But normally I like to try and group my extern crates up at the very top, followed by mods, followed by uses. But then I'm also defining some new modules down below that uses, so blah. But okay, so I've got this API module, which is going to be followed by, I guess, wrong language. I was about to def some things. This is not Python. So index is here. Trying to think of where I want to read this stuff from, and I guess I'll do it in place. I won't move the directory around or anything like that. So basically where I did my npm build, I'll just point these handlers at the build result directory. So following the example, we've got a result of named file. The reason result is a part of the responder signature here is so that I guess, like if the file doesn't exist, we can get a 404, something like that. So take a look at the directory structure. So here's what came out. We got our build directory with index.html, which will bootstrap the single page app. We also got a bunch of stuff written out to static. Interesting. So I guess what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with just front end build index.html. And I use this this macro that Rocket provides to define the method and the path info for my route. And so this other handler, what is this going to be? I guess files is fair. I'm going to call it spa files for my single page application. And so this is going to take a file parameter, which is going to be a path buff. Which is we're going to use dynamic pathing for this. So any request that comes in that starts with a slash and follows some stuff. So the dot 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 here means that there can be more slashes that appear. So this is like basically a greedy capture. I think that's the gist there. It's not a regex exactly, but it's a similar idea. So I'm just following. Oops. Ew. And so I believe the deal is that named file open is going to basically be a result type. So there could be a failure there. It could fail to read, kind of like we have with the index. And the dot OK takes that result and turns it into an option. And that's what gets us a 404. So if the option is none, you get a 404 response, and if the option is some glob of bytes, then you get the bytes back. All right. So we got some new routes we can load up in this macro. Spa files and index. So let's see if that even builds. Where's my stuff? God damn it, Windows. Okay. Didn't like that. File, not a valid identifier. Really? Why the hell not? Isn't this exactly what I just looked at? Named file is private, really. Blah. Oh. Yeah. My bad, Rocket. Okay, so we're changing the game now. Previously, I was running the Webpack dev server with a reverse proxy configured on it. So it was mounting the routes for the data on the server as local URIs. But now, I should be able to switch to, 8,000? Port 8,000, and this would be the Rocket app. Great. Okay. So there's the Rocket app. This is our production build, which should be a little quicker. And so here's the thing that was really freaking me out, and that was the response times for toggling a single field on a record. And so that first one was 300 milliseconds, which is still, I don't understand, but oh, you know what, maybe that was just like an initial provisioning of a database connection, something like that. Oh, look at that. Yeah, we're still getting the occasional 300. But it's definitely much more in line with what I would expect. Yeah, if I let the app idle for a minute, and we're back to 300s. Otherwise, it's yeah. Okay, interesting. So did I check this with the? So part of me wonders if this isn't related to the release build that I am running right now, which is always like the gotcha with Rust. Like, oh, my Rust is slow. And then you realize you've been running it in debug mode or a debug build. And then you do a release build and everything is crazy fast. But either way, the occasional 300 millisecond response is going to be fine for this. But it looks like all of our pathing and all the URLs and stuff are mapped nicely. And so this is basically how I'm going to run the app for the real show when we get into playing the game. So what I need to do now is to update the OBS browser source. Let's see. R4. So I'll switch that from port 3000 to port 8000. That even feels like it's loading a little faster. Yeah, good. Good. Okay, well, I guess that was static file handling. The biggest blunder I made was to sneak case this this referenced and named file. And the biggest blunder that Rocket made was to not talk about handling static files anywhere in the main docs, and to consider that something that you would need to look at the example code for. Shame on you. So I guess we're done. Is that real? Let's do a little commit here. Oh, you know what? There is something else I should do, and that is I'll do a little cargo Clippy. Clippy's got nothing to say. And a little cargo format. Everything looks close enough. All right. Okay. That's a wrap. Exciting stuff. Seems like got the keyboard nav kind of going. We got highlighting of active stuff. For zone, we got the check boxes happening. What did that just do? Oh yeah, it moved because that was the only active item. I checked it. I forgot I added that. It was a late night last night. Thanks. Now, hold on. So the background of this element, whatever it is, I don't know if you can see, like right here, is not black. It's the off black that I have that's meant to be inside of these groups. I don't know. I feel like you know what? Yep, that's something I'm gonna do. I was just going back and forth on this, but so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna sample that color, and then I'm gonna put a background plate on the entire stream, and that way I can match that color instead of the pure black that we have here as the background. We'll have the Metal Gear black. Which is just a little lighter than black. It's got a little brandy green tint to it. So, all right, that'll be. Oh, I guess I can do that right now while I'm here. So let me just check to see what that color is. So this body background is meant to be black, I guess. But I guess that doesn't really matter. What I'll do is I'll swap that out. Yeah, I think it's this color. This panel BG. Define text color as a variable, even though it's only used by name one place here, I think. Okay. So we've got this panel BG color, and then in OBS, I will add a color source, which will be MGS3 black, which is different than the regular black, and the color will be that one. Okay. And the size doesn't really matter, because I'm gonna scale it. And this isn't actually the scene that I wanted that in. So I gotta bring it in. Where'd it go? Of course. Nope, shit. Source, add existing, go back to coding and pull that out. So this is going to go all the way to the bottom, and then I'm going to stretch it, and I'm going to lock it, lock all this stuff. So, just gonna check the preview. Bring up my interact panel. There we go. Alright, so now that's a nice consistent color. I don't have that weird seam that I saw before. I wish I had more camera space over here so I didn't clip out, but that's all right. I get a little bleed into the game space. As long as I don't lean too far over, it's workable. Screen showing. There's the extents. Yeah, not too bad. I wonder about the gutter that I have here. I could I don't have a sense about whether or not I would want that to be slightly bigger or smaller or what. Yikes. Yeah, I guess that's where it's gonna go. Oh, right, so, the finishing touches, I was going to add some text. But let's see what I can even find. So maybe I can find, like, a nice transparent image. I'm going to say I'm done with this. Let's see, Snake Eater logo. Can I get a nice, like, one line? So these aren't exactly what I'm looking for, but this is kind of close. I wonder. I wonder if I can just find something I can use without having to edit it a whole lot. Try this. I feel like the thing here is that it's going to be too tall. So I've got some overlap there, but I'm thinking that maybe I can do a filter on it with a color key. And so with that color key in place, I should be able to just slide that out a little bit. Oops. That is great.
tree frog. It's so deep, the trial to survive.
Check the preview again. Make sure it's not too crazy pixelated or anything. Yeah, it looks okay, I guess. Yeah, that's feeling a little better. What's wrong with that? Seems pretty good. And so now, I wonder if I'll be able to load a text element that uses a custom font without like installing the font. No, I will. I will totally have to install the font if I want to do that. And that makes me want to just not do it. And only part of the reason for that is I haven't installed a font on a Windows system in a crazy amount of time, because who the fuck does that? I really don't want to have to research it. I'm sure it's super easy these days, but basically, no, just forget about it. So I'm looking through the system fonts right now, just seeing if there's anything that I can pass off as a match for the custom one that I found. And there's also another thing that I could do, which is to basically build a little web page and load that in. Or I can just not. I can just not. That's what I'm gonna do. Alright, well. My overlay is pretty much locked in at this point. 048. We're ready to go. So, what I think I'm going to do is, I'm going to order some food, and I'm going to eat some dinner. It's only 4:30, but, oh well. Yeah, so I'm gonna order some food, eat some dinner, finish up my laundry, and I'll be back on to kick off the actual game in, I don't know, maybe like an hour or two. That sounds about right. Yeah, I'm excited. I'm excited to collect all the animals and eat them. It's gonna be great. All right. Well. I guess I'll. Yep. I will just sign off. And I'll be back before you know it.